afternoon, everyone. Welcome. I'm Tom Collins. I'm president of the Barnes Foundation, and it's a great pleasure to have you here this afternoon. Thank you to everyone who stood by us during our fire drill. I appreciate that. You'll be pleased to know it was our second one of the week, so it took us approximately half the time to get through it today. Thanks for sticking around. I'm going to introduce the program, and in the interest of concision and in the interest of acknowledging the many institutions and people that helped us on this program, I'm going to read. I hope you'll indulge me for just 2 minutes, because the rest of this is going to be rather freewheeling, so the last time you'll see notes. Earlier this year, we here at the Barnes Foundation completed a new institutional strategic plan that is intended to guide us as we grow the Barnes service, our artistic, educational, and social service, into our second century, which begins in 2022. At the heart of this new strategic plan is our commitment to pioneer and pursue strategies for making Dr. Barnes' twin passions, on the one hand, progressive education about and through the visual arts, and on the other, diversity, inclusion, and social justice, to evolve those into the 21st century. You've joined us today for the first in what we imagine will be a series of 2x4 innovation forums in which we will discuss one set of challenges we face as we attempt to carry out this mission. We've explicitly committed ourselves in this new plan to the goal of mirroring the diversity of Philadelphia in our audiences, our staff, and our board. And so we lead today with the very broad question, how can we grow our audience to be more reflective of Philadelphia? To help us answer this question, we have brought together two distinguished colleagues to my right, your left, who are leaders in this field. Maria Arias, who is Vice President of Diversity and Inclusion at Comcast Corporation, and probably many of you know Siobhan Reardon. Siobhan is the President and Director of the Free Library of Philadelphia. Terrific colleagues, and I'm so glad they're here today. Thank
Happy
you
to
very
be here.
Much. And we are here together with four students from Drexel University's Excite Center: Nicole Feller-Johnson, Maren Larson, Mai Noyan, and Kenneth Nimley. Welcome. Thank you for being here. And I want to acknowledge two of my colleagues here at the Barnes Foundation. First, Barbara Wong, who is our new Director of Community Engagement. Barbara's here in the front. Please join me in welcoming Barbara to the staff. And many of you probably know Shelley Bernstein. Shelley is our Deputy Director for Digital Initiatives, but our Chief Experience Officer. And you're going to be hearing a bit from Shelley today. This is really Shelley's brainchild. So Shelley, thank you very much. And together, we are all going to share first some data, and then we're going to talk through its implications. Each of our partners from the Excite Center will then have a few minutes to present one or more specific ideas about audience diversification in this program. And then finally, we're going to open things up to conversation. And we have a hard stop at right around 4:30, so we promise we will be as quick as we can. I want to acknowledge that the data that Shelley's going to be presenting to kick off each of four discussion topics today was produced in cooperation with Be Heard Philly, which is Temple University's Institute for Survey Research. And this working group has used this data throughout the week in a series of private conversations that lead us up to this moment. So you'll be hearing a few select data points momentarily. And so before I turn things over to Shelley, I want to thank Excite Center's Youngmoo Kim and Carol Lindstrom for helping us to both plan and populate this conversation with really extraordinary new colleagues. I'd also like to thank Drexel University's LeBeau College of Business for their critical sponsorship of this first 2x4 forum. And with that, Shelley Bernstein.
Okay. So when we started this project, we wanted to look at data and think about data-driven decisions. And one of the first things we wanted to do is see how we're doing. And this is how we're doing today. These are the demographics of Philadelphia, and these are the Barnes demographics of our audiences. This does not include the school partnerships that we work with, so there are 11,000 school kids that are not represented by this data. But what you see here is a pretty stark difference, and I'm going to throw this right back to Tom to start talking about it.
So how we're going to proceed today is Shelley's going to offer a data point and a little bit of analysis. This is the first. And then I'm going to turn immediately to our experts, and I'm going to ask them first for some general observations about this data.
So, sure, I'll go ahead and start. Thanks everyone for joining us this afternoon. I think as everyone can see, it's kind of incongruous, and there's a real opportunity when you look at what the population of Philadelphia is today and the major surrounding areas, as well as those who actually attend the Barnes. The fact is that what's happening in Philadelphia mirrors what's happening in many major cities, as well as actually some smaller cities, with kind of the changing demographics that we've all seen as a result that were pronounced in the 2010 census data, as well as newer studies. For example, some of the studies we reviewed in preparation for this that gave us the Philadelphia statistics in 2015. The fact is we have a very multicultural community here. We have a lot of opportunity to grow the membership and the attendees at the Barnes, and really looking forward to the discussion to talk about how we can bridge the gap between those in the city and those who actually know of and come to the Barnes.
One of the things I'll add to this, and good afternoon everyone, is you have to remember the Barnes is very much a Center City institution. And when you look at the Free Library of Philadelphia, we kind of have a ubiquitous presence, so our users actually reflect the better part of the demographics of the city of Philadelphia just because of the nature of our work. And so naturally, there is a variation, and we see it as well in our programming and usership. What happens here in Center City is not what happens in our neighborhood libraries. And so therefore, your services and your reach and the way you have the conversation with community is necessarily different. And so you do look at education levels, literacy levels, you look at access issues. And for many Philadelphians, one of the things Philadelphians don't do easily is traverse neighborhoods. It's not, most people are not gonna come easily from North Philadelphia or West Philadelphia to come to Center Cities. And so therefore, as Maria said, there is a real opportunity for the Barnes to understand who's in association in these neighborhoods so that their reach is much more broad spectrum Philadelphia.
Yeah. You raised this point in one of our private conversations, and it was very interesting to me, and I didn't really ask the appropriate follow-up. So I want to ask you what you think that is about, right? This kind of, we face a very serious challenge. We have some very nuanced data about who's coming to the Barnes and from what zip codes in the city. Mm-hmm. And we have neighborhoods we simply don't reach.
Right.
And I'm wondering what you think we need to consider as we imagine.
Well, I think as we all know, Philadelphia is actually a fairly poor city, and that is pretty reflected in the neighborhoods. And so a lot of people if you're in the neighborhoods in North Philadelphia, West Philadelphia, Southwest Philadelphia, you watch where you spend your money. And if in fact you're making a decision between taking a bus trip into Center City or buying food for your family, those are the decisions that are being made. And so how is it we understand the local economies in some of these neighborhoods and how every single citizen has the right to access to what's here in the Barnes, and so how is it we push that out? I think it's what I'm more concerned that you have a deeper reach into community versus the community coming to
mm-hmm.
you. So it's an issue in librarianship, and one of the things that we talk about within our own libraries is we are a fairly passive profession, and we wait for people to come through the door, up those big giant steps into this temple of knowledge and ask us a reference question. Well, that's not happening anymore, and so the paradigm shift is actually looking more deeply into community to understand what that relation needs to be so that people are actually using the Free Library of Philadelphia and all that we can provide. And so your libraries actually tend to be, and I think the Barnes in any museum is actually far more ubiquitous than you actually give yourselves credit for,
mm-hmm.
Because you're so building based.
Mm-hmm. But you mentioned that, of course, you are in the neighborhoods that you serve.
Yes.
You have hubs
mm-hmm.
in those neighborhoods.
Yes.
So
yes.
Our challenge, of course, is that we're here,
right.
Obviously.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe Maria has more of a perspective as you make decisions about what subpopulations that you are going to target with various initiatives and how you make those decisions and what that might suggest for the way we make those decisions. We could, of course, be serving many subpopulations, mm-hmm. many different neighborhoods. How do you make those decisions in your initiatives, and what might that teach us?
Absolutely. One other data point that I'd like to add that I think just complements what Siobhan said and what the data shows is that the recent study on Philadelphia also shows that about 12% of the population is immigrant.
Mm-hmm.
So in addition to the low income and the multicultural nature, you also have a language barrier, which is a topic that I think as we discuss other strategies for the museum we can touch. But When we look, for example, at our very large company with many businesses across the entire country, we do this demographic analysis of the communities that actually are in our employee base. We look at the census data because we also have a commitment to reflect the communities where we live and serve. And so what we do is see where we're strong, where we're not strong in representation, and a huge part of our initiatives are community partnerships, which I think is a real opportunity for the Barnes, because in order to reach out to the communities and create awareness where there may not be some, because the data shows that there isn't awareness of the Barnes in all communities, those community partners can be key to providing the information and to being the center sources. For example, if you can't get people to come to the Barnes to do more innovative and interactive things, for example, streaming programming and or crowdsourcing ideas or hackathons or different things that you can do with the community partners to get exposed to the Barnes, the culture, the history. And one of the things that we talked about as well with our colleagues in the group here is how do we connect all the different diverse communities, help them find a connection to the collection here at the Barnes.
I think hopefully we'll come back to that in a moment, but I'm very interested to know, Siobhan, you told us a story yesterday about some analysis that you were able to do with Experian. Mm-hmm. You know, we talked about the fact that we first have to know these communities we're trying to reach, and this is a relatively new enterprise for the Barnes and many cultural institutions. But you did something very novel, which I think is suggestive.
So, you know, I think we're all about audience development. There's no doubt about it. And so, including the Free Library of Philadelphia. And so we're very excited that we have 500,000 cardholders. That's a giant number. There's 1.6 million people that live here in Philadelphia, but I'd like us to have 1.6 million cardholders, right? So what we did was we worked with Experian to understand, you know, through our database of cardholders, where our cardholders exist, and it's pretty dispersed around the city, but what it did was really hone in on the areas where there were street addresses that where there wasn't a cardholder, not even a child in the family had a card. And so this gives us an opportunity to understand at a very hyper-local level where it is we our marketing efforts need to go, the kind of outreach efforts we need to sort of pursue in our local neighborhood libraries. But it was very powerful data because, you know, whenever you see those spots where there's not even you can go block after block after block, and particularly West Philadelphia was where we were noticing just giant gaps, and said we have a lot of work to do in these communities.
Interesting. And what else did you take away from that in terms of your coming to understand your audiences how about your audiences? What have you been able to discover about the audiences that you're not reaching?
I think for us it's about why aren't people taking advantage of the Free Library of Philadelphia? And it's very interesting. I'll just use West Philadelphia for instance. It is so interesting. So we have any number of 20 libraries in West Philadelphia. So you can walk among many of the libraries, but that doesn't happen. So one of the issues for us is that we have come to discover in some locations we established a hotspot to try and reach communities at a very hyper-local level, where we put a digital learning center in a local community-based organization. And what we learned in that experiment, it's not an experiment, we still have them, is that how many people, almost to a person we began working with, never crossed the transom of a public library. Why? Because they thought they had to be literate in order to use a public library. Mm-hmm. Blew us away, said we have to change our issues around, so what are the barriers? So clearly, not only the physical barriers exist, but there's also the intellectual barriers that we present in the way we present our materials or even present ourselves. You know, we sit behind these big desks and, you know, we've got these big computers, and it's a pretty intimidating process. And so, you know, as we look at our 21st Century Library Initiative, it is all about breaking down those barriers and creating more entries to access. So access has become a big issue for us.
And mm-hmm. as it is for us as well. Yeah. So we will be coming back in a moment to this question about how we get people over the threshold for the first time, what we have to think about, mm-hmm. what we have to do. So we'll circle back to that in a minute because lightning round one is over. So let me return things to Shelley for lightning round two.
Okay, so lightning round two is about drivers of visitation. Most of this is coming directly from Be Heard Philly. The permanent collection as a driver is one for those who have visited, but much less of one for those who have not. The reverse is almost true for the special exhibitions. Of those who have visited, it's less of a driver, but of those who have not visited, it's more of a driver, so they're really looking for that. And then you start to see that same kind of data trend happen in the public programs as a primary driver, where you see those who have not visited, that's a fairly substantial rise there from those who have visited. Interestingly, we have ticket scanning data to compare to this, and what we're seeing on the ticket scanning is that if you enter the building, there's a 31.6% crossover rate, which means if you're gonna get here, there's a fairly high chance that you're gonna go see the other thing while you're here. So if we can get people here, they tend to see both at a fairly high rate.
Some general observations about this data before we dig in?
One of the things that we talked about was the rise of the millennial population and how young Philadelphia has become as a city when you look at the average age. And I think a real opportunity for the Barnes is some of the learnings that they're getting from the PICO-free Sundays and the data from millennials about knowledge of the Barnes and what they want and the interactivity and making the Barnes attractive not just to millennial students, for example, but also to the young families, because when you think about not just getting someone to come in, but to come back and to create experiences the way other museums across the country that are trying to drive audience participation is to look at the programming that will cut across for those young millennial families that tend to be, some are cost conscious, some really are more about the interests and really go, as we learned yesterday, going deep into certain subjects and creating an environment that's going to be very attractive to them.
Mm-hmm. And I want to say that this is such a vast collection, and there's always some very interesting, you know, when you walk through a collection with a curator or someone like Tom, and all of a sudden they point out very interesting items in the collection, you're sitting there going, I had no idea about this. So I think it was, we were women of the evening as the objects. And of course, I was like, get out of here. And so, but anyway, so there we are. And I was like, wouldn't it be interesting? It's about how it is you attract people by using less classical methods into sort of, so, you know, it's almost like, you know, where's Waldo? And so kind of an opportunity, because I do think that, you know, art can be intimidating and the whole concept around the sort of the intellectual aspects of art. And I think for just even my users who think you have to be literate in order to use a public library, I think that there's that sort of, how do we make sure that people understand this is for everybody? Because as we were saying yesterday, that many of the artists who produced this work were starving, hungry, homeless, you know, pretty desperate people. And so relating those stories, I think the storytelling around art and artists and the objects, I think is incredible, and it has tremendous reach no matter what community you're talking about. And I do think you have an opportunity, particularly with the millennials, because they're so curious. My God, such a curious group of people that really are just love to get at information, absorb information, dissect information, and figure out who is it that they can share this with, which is why, you know, places like this and beer gardens and restaurants and just the Johnny Brenda's, which is my favorite place, to just to really sort of dive deep into a topic and really explore it.
One of you yesterday, I can't recall, maybe both of you, said something that's so simple but so profound, which is that to attract people to an institution like this, people have to be able to see themselves in what is happening here in some way. And I'm wondering if you could talk a little bit about what you mean by that.
Sure. I think I raised that because that's something that we really think about when we've been launching our inclusion program at Comcast, not just focusing on, you know, the diversity part, but whether it's employees with disabilities or the LGBT community or veterans and the military population. But it's really, until I got this role, was never sensitized to the importance of diversity in front of the camera. I just kind of acclimated and assimilated. I'm an immigrant from Mexico and just took for granted that I even started dressing. I was in a law firm, kind of like my male colleagues, you know, the suit and the little bow tie. I mean, I felt like I had to do that to assimilate. And in this role, I literally started counting on the different programs and started noticing the stereotypes. And I think particularly for a population that's young and multicultural, and unfortunately a large part of it is, you know, in the poverty level, we need to make sure that they can see themselves, they can see individuals at the library in terms of not the staff in traditional roles, but diverse individuals talking to them about the collection, making the connection, talking to them in their language. We talked a little bit about the audios, and not just here at the Barnes, but in other museums that I've gone to, like, if I'm listening to that and it's English as a second language, you know, which honestly it was for me when I came to this country, I'm just not going to connect. It's almost like you think back at some of the studies that have come out a long time ago about the ACT and SATs and how for low-income and multicultural communities, sometimes the scores are just so vastly different, and part of it is the language and the way it's written. So it goes a little bit deeper and kind of digging down, and you have to be able to see yourself a little bit somehow, or have somebody be able to make the connection to your community and your culture to get that hook. Because if you get that emotional hook, you're going to get them, and they're going to want to come back, and they're going to want to tell their friends and their families.
So I want to say that there's a way I think about this, and I think the Barnes has a giant opportunity here using technology, using just vast amounts of technology to sort of push out images in the collection to the local neighborhoods and into the, whether you use the library as your venue or whatever local initiative. But I mean, say for instance you want to use connect with our libraries, there's ways that you can stream images to these and individuals in the local community to explain what's going on. What do you see? How do you see it? What does it mean to you? Because I do think it really does help with that translation. You're not thinking in a way that the folks in, you know, in North Philadelphia are thinking, and or Northwest Philadelphia or Northeast Philadelphia. I mean, these are different communities with very different cultural assets to them, and you know, we speak one way here in Center City because we're kind of an intellectual hub. I'm just going to say that, but I think it's not that there isn't intellectual hubs throughout the city. I think what we have to do is push out the glory of what's here and into the neighborhoods, because I do think that awareness is everything, and approach is everything, and access becomes the thing that's going to hook you in.
So we talked pretty extensively yesterday about two particular challenges the Barnes faces. One is the fact, of course, that it is a collection that we're best known for a collection of European modernism. And if we're talking about offering diverse audiences an opportunity to see themselves in what we do here, we have to figure out how to create a reception horizon that extends from that work, which is principally white and privileged and male, produced at least in that way, to an audience that does not look like that. And you had some very interesting suggestions about what we may think about, how we might think about that yesterday.
Well, I think one of the things that we talked about was really bringing it down a level, you know, because we assume that this collection is only going to be appealing to a certain audience. And I think finding a way to link the history of Mr. Barnes and his passion for inclusion and social justice, and talking a little bit about the artists, and maybe making connections to artists in other communities of the time who learned from each other from different diverse communities, is a way to kind of build that bridge, because otherwise there's almost kind of the impression of what this is, but it's broader than this, because art is really a story to tell, and it that gets to how do we describe the collection at the Barnes today? How do we need to describe it in the future, whether it's internally here for those who come, or cascading it to the community partners, or through all the technology and the great alliances that Siobhan has mentioned? I think that whenever you have the need and the desire to have a cultural transformation, it's a slow and iterative process, and really requires peeling back to the fundamental layers and then kind of developing the plan on how you're going to do that. It's, you know, when I think about what we've done at Comcast in terms of rolling out our diversity and inclusion program, you can launch a lot of things, but until you got to fundamental awareness about things like unconscious bias and assumptions and little micro inequities, the things that people do that people don't realize really offend people, words that are used that might offend certain communities, it's almost like kind of starting at zero and creating that awareness, and then figuring out what the plan is to get to where you want to go. And I think that it's just amazing that the Barnes has this as part of its strategic mission and vision. It's smart, because if you look at the census data, whether it's here in Philadelphia or elsewhere, it's the demographics are just changing. and particularly millennials have grown up in a global environment, and the younger generation as well, because of the power of the internet. It's not just what's happening in Philadelphia that's relevant, it's what's happening in the entire world. And that's just different than what it was like when I grew up.
Right, and I just want to, one of the things about art, and we were talking about this yesterday, that the way you look, you imagine that the image that's here in the eyes of the artist that was painting it at the time, and I think the conversation has to change to what you see as a person in the 21st century, what that object means to you, and what's happening in that image. It's probably different, and that conversation is necessarily, because I know some of the students were, you know, challenged by what they were seeing.
Yes.
And so, and that's fair, because in the way that we have now evolved as a society, you know, there's much more progress in women and art. And the conversations are necessarily different about what gets painted and what doesn't get painted, and sort of the, I just think the allowances are different. But I also think what also doesn't get discussed about the barns, which is probably some of the more most interesting parts of the collection, is all of the African art here and all of the folk art that's here. And I think that you know, we talk about the Impressionists, and it is an amazing collection, but I think that there's just so much more to explore when you think about everything else that's here.
Yes.
And then what that means culturally, because I think you really can get into some of the cultural aspects of from where this art comes, or from you know, what it meant to that society to see these objects.
And you're alluding, Siobhan is alluding to another part of the conversation we had yesterday, and this is germane to what I refer to as our other unique challenge here at the Barnes, which is that historically, this institution has not invested in unpacking the ideas and the histories that are represented by the pictures and objects in our collection beyond the method that was pioneered by Dr. Barnes, which is, you know, we loosely relate now to visual literacy education, and that is something we're actively doing. And by unpacking those ideas, by telling those stories, we create many more points of entry, many more points of connection, and I think we'll probably hear some ideas that are related to that idea momentarily. But lightning round two is now over. We move on to lightning three.
So we're looking at user experience needs. What are people really looking for when they come to visit, right? And what we see is that the social visit with friends or family is, in fact, a primary driver. In fact, it's almost 63-67% among both groups. Family visits as a primary driver is something that is incredibly important to both. I actually think this is reversed. This is a typo, I'm sorry. Of those who have visited, it's only 20%, but of those who have not, it's at 42%. So those who have not visited are really looking as family visit as a primary driver. And the primary reasons people state for not visiting museums at all is that they don't have time, but outside of that, museums are not for me, and don't like museums were very, very high.
General impressions.
So I'm gonna, you know, I'm curious, if you don't mind me asking a question about when you're looking at visitation drivers, what was the age, what was the average, you know, what were the age groupings that we were talking about on this?
I would need to look.
Okay, I don't mean to put you on the spot,
yeah.
Because, you know, and we're gonna go back to have a conversation around millennials and how experiential they are, and if you are, and if what's happening in a space, in a building in Center City, and it's a lot of objects, and you're walking around and you're looking at the objects, and there's not a whole lot of interaction, there's not a whole lot of sort of deliberate conversation and energy exploring, sort of with you, when you go with your friends, you know, you want to have a big conversation, you're probably shushed to death, like you are in a library. It's really quite amazing. So when you want to have elaborate conversations, you really want to have a free run of the place. I think that's where you kind of have to take some of the state's rigor out of what I think people believe are museum experiences pretty universally.
Yeah, I would agree. I mean, I think about in the past when our museums and different art collections like this weren't accessible because we didn't have the ADA and rules on accessibility. And again, going back to the stats, Philadelphia has about 12% of its population has some kind of disability. Mm-hmm. And these are folks under the age of 65, so it's not the elderly. And is part of the strategic plan. It's what audience do you want to capture? Do you want to capture a certain age group, a certain subset, you know, to bring children to the barns versus other museums and other areas in other cultural exhibits? There's usually a children's area or something that you can do. So really figuring out a way to bring in audiences by creating opportunities for them to bring not just themselves and in a social setting or with more adult family members, but making it a family experience. One of the things we talked about was, and you know, there's the physical collection here, but there's the opportunity, given this wonderful campus, to do different things outside and to stream outside and to create events outside, whether it's for millennials or for family, and to join with the free library and other organizations to do different kinds of events as kind of the draw and the marketing tool, but also to do a lot of this education about how, you know, this collection can speak to many, many different audiences, not the audience that's just coming today.
So let's assume that we can answer the first two questions that we posed in a meaningful way. We come to know the audience segments that we're not engaging in a nuanced way, and we know how to engage them, and we're engaging them in the proper way, communicating with them, right? What kinds of threshold considerations must we make, right? What kinds of things, what kinds of questions must we be able to ask on and answer on behalf of potential audiences once we've connected with them in terms of communication?
One of the things I think is could make sort of reaching the sort of younger audiences, let me just put it that way, or just even multicultural audiences, is ensuring that the access points of people who are welcoming and who are going to be your docents and who are going to be sort of your those are the people who are going to guide you through the collections. They're the people who are going to your educators have a real feel and understanding for the group that's in front of them, because not everybody comes to information, not everybody comes to learning in exactly the same way. And then of course there are language barriers for the people that are coming in who are not first English speakers. So I do think all of that has to be part of the threshold as you begin. I realize this is a giant leap forward, but I do think that as people begin to experience it, they're finding themselves in the people that work here, and they find themselves in what's around here. And so when they finish with their experience with the barns, what else is here for them? Because they've made the effort to come here and be part of this.
Yes. And we're going to talk about price and those kinds of considerations last. We also show this might be a moment to say one a little bit about this audience facing staff question in terms of diversity.
We took some metrics on the Barnes trustee makeup and the Barnes staff, and we've got a 17% minority, 54% women work at the Barnes. And the trustees, do you want to talk about the trustees a little bit?
I think it's more interesting at this point just to talk about this question about once you connect with people, offer them something they want, and get them here, they have an experience where they once again can see themselves in the staff that are engaging them, frontline staff, so educators, visitor services, and so forth. Mm-hmm. We're going to talk about cost as a threshold consideration in a moment.
One thing I wanted to add to the equation is I think that when you think of some other types of museums, like a history museum or a science and industry museum, I grew up in Chicago, they do a lot of education about what you're seeing and why is that important. And that's what struck me. Like, how can I get different audiences to come and want to see this art when maybe they would prefer to see a different type of art from their own community? And to me, it's how do you explain to them why this art was so important in its moment in time? What was happening in the world, not just in the country where it was painted or created, the African art? How do you draw that link and provide a context? Because I think that's something. You know, we talked a little bit about how it's intimidating. You know, it's like, you know, I took art in college, right? You know, I'll admit I'm not an art aficionado, but I love going and I love seeing, but I always feel like I should know more. and I love going to places where I have different ways to learn about what I'm seeing and draw the connections. And that's something that I think is a potential opportunity here when you're thinking about how do you make that connection to your potential audiences as well? And that would be one of the things about once you've targeted your audience and you've gotten them in, you want to make them come back,
right,
and help them understand why is this so important, and you know what part of history did this play, and how does that connect to other parts? And particularly something that I mentioned yesterday, given this environment right now, with the election and just kind of the sensitivities that are out there about diverse communities and how they're feeling, it's a real opportune time to make a connection.
Should we move on to data set four and talk about resources briefly?
So one of the things we wanted to look at was cost. This is another point in the data that's fairly interesting, especially when you start to pair it with other sets of data that we have available to us. So in the Be Heard Philly data, the consideration of cost is roughly equal among the two groups. For those who have visited, it's a 29% of those have that concern. From those who have not visited, 27%. Of that set, it's interesting content and appropriate for kids were more motivating for audiences. When we compare that with Barnes free programming, keep in mind that our general admission price here is $25. When we do free programming, this is the kind of audience that we see come in the door, 50% millennial, 30% identify as a person of color, 20% earning under $35K. So we start to see that tide shift when you think about that original slide of our audiences. And you know, when you turn back to the Be Heard Philly data, you see some things that say things like, of those who never go to museums, the reason too expensive was much lower than other considerations, such as don't like, not for me, no time. So we know it's an important driver, but it is certainly conflicted in our on-site data versus the data that we've captured here from Be Heard Philly.
So I'm so not surprised that you'll have more people when it's free.
like everything else.
But I have to say it's a stroke of genius to do it, because if you're looking to engage and enlarge the audience, and free programming is going to be a thing, especially if it's really enticing free programming that's going to get out some social issue or some amazing conversation that folks have been wanting to have, and the venue or the opportunity hasn't arisen, and all of a sudden there it is. And I will make my way to Center City, Philadelphia, to do this, to participate. But you have to remember, so it's 50% millennial, so that doesn't surprise me either, because this is a group of people that loves to be informed. They are at information gathering, and if it's for free, they're going. And if there's a free beer there, they're really doubly going. So, but you can't underestimate the importance of civic engagement on a lot of this. And I think if the programming and the object around social justice, which as a main theme of not only Dr. Barnes but your next plan, is really going to start. It's going to be that thing that's going to be attracting people, because then they're here, and then there's the curiosity around the collection, and then there's curiosity around other types of programming and what else is going on, and feed me more. I'm not surprised.
Yeah, I agree with that. The one thing I was thinking about our discussion and how do you create the draw and how do you create the connection, and I was actually really surprised that it wasn't cost, that it was time. So then my next question is, how do I make it important and interesting enough to want to go, given the priorities and the conflicts that, and especially, you know, young families or millennials still in school or working. And the thought that came to me in order to draw that connection is, particularly since we have all these heritage months, but you have a certain collection, to create some kind of educational session during those heritage months for the different communities and provide it as an opportunity to link to the collection. Because, you know, we've talked about other museums bring in lots of different collections, and so that's a way to draw new audiences and create the interest. But here there's a real opportunity to satisfy kind of the needs of the audience, find a way to provide some education about the collection and build the connection, and again, possibly partner with different community organizations to provide that expertise and have the panel discussions. We do that a lot for our different heritage months, it's an opportunity to educate, and it's been very, very successful.
Two quick follow-up questions for both of you. The question of perceived value. So we have offered an increasing number of free programs this year, and it's paid off in terms of audience diversification. Do we do ourselves at any level a disservice with regard to the question of perceived value if we're giving so much away?
Yes and no. I would say how many of those, I know that was really, that was really, really helpful. But I would be very curious to know, what was, if there was any percentage of people that came here for the pre-program, came again for a pre-program, finally became a member. And so I can't imagine that didn't happen because they found value. I do believe that there is value because you attracted somebody and you were consistent in the approach and consistent in the quality of the programming you were providing. There's no way people aren't going to be attracted to come back and then finally, you know, drop the dime that you need them to be dropping
on
the organization.
Well, the other piece of the data that we talked about yesterday it sort of supports that idea, right? Because it was surprising. We did diversify our audiences pretty wildly during some of these free programs, but there was a large, unpredictably large percentage of people that came to those free events that were in our typical demographic, right? They were highly educated, economically comfortable, and so forth. And presumably they are coming to test the offering, right? That's the enticement, and we hope that they will be easy to upstream or easier to upstream.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I was going to add that, you know, all businesses do this. Mm. We all offer something either at a discount or a free trial period to try to bring people in. It's kind of, you know, doing the math and doing the analysis and doing different pilots and tests to see what's going to work. You don't want to totally undercut, you know, your revenue stream, because we do have examples. I believe it was Dallas that went free, and then there was some financial concerns. But interestingly enough, they grew their diverse audience and they kept that diverse audience. So that there's a case to be made for that.
Just
but
not their director.
Yeah. We don't want that to happen.
True story.
So, but I think it's like a business, right? Not the responsibility at the barns, just like at any business, is to make sure you're financially stable, that you're diversified, that you have a plan, that you have a plan B if plan A doesn't work. So even though there's always that concern, it makes sense to do it in a methodical and strategic way to test it and have a couple of different options to see what works and what doesn't work, and then to build upon those learnings, because at the end of the day, you know, particularly in competitive industries, you're seeing the constantly, almost monthly changing dynamics of how competitors are responding to each other, and they're all doing the math, trying to figure out, can I do this or that to match? Everybody has a loss leader when they're trying to come in and break a market. So, you know, personally, I think it makes sense.
Mm-hmm. I do too. Mm-hmm.
So I want to thank Siobhan and Maria for this lightning round. You can imagine this is the tip of the iceberg, but you get some sense of the landscape that we've covered in some of these private conversations and some sense of the questions that we're asking of ourselves and we're being asked by members of our community. I would like now to turn things to our guests from Drexel's Excite Center, and I believe Maren's going to give us an introduction.
Great. Well, we're students from the Excite Center at Drexel University. And we've been here for 3 days working in sort of a intensive manner on this question, which was mentioned earlier. How can the barns better reflect the people of Philadelphia, basically, which, you know, we've been also been talking about for the last 40 minutes. So we came up with a solution that includes two parts, a proposed solution. So the first part is to rebrand the barns and put forward the idea that everybody internally has of the barns as this place of education and inclusivity, and tear down those notions of inaccessibility that come with the words like masterpiece and foundation that are sort of hard to digest for a lot of people, and put forward those more democratizing ideas. And then the second part is to build a community hub, build a place where the communities of Philadelphia, all the communities of Philadelphia, feel welcomed.
Hi, I'm Nicole Feller-Johnson. I'm a double major graduate student in Drexel's new design research program, as well as fashion design. I'm going to talk with you a little bit today about our rebranding strategies. We are primarily focusing on building relationships with millennials and underserved populations. So We've created a word cloud based on some qualitative data provided to us by Be Heard Philly. When you're looking at the left-hand side word cloud, that represents old perceptions, ideas that people have about the Barnes Foundation. The perceptions that we hear repeated are in larger type, so you can see where people's priorities are, what they're thinking about the situation, how the history of the Barnes has contributed to their perception of what's here now. On the left, we have an idealized word cloud, which is our vision of what we'd like to communicate about Barnes, what we're hearing being here as part of a team, what we're hearing from staff members, what we're hearing about the Barnesian philosophy. To this end, we've redesigned a logo, Barnes as standing for art, education, and community, which we believe are at the core of your values here. We would like to promote family and social use with friends. We want people to see the Barnes Museum as a place of creation and exploration, not a staid collection. And so we've created the hashtag #IBelongBarnes because we want people to know that it is a place of welcoming and they have a place here. It is not just for one demographic, it's for all demographics. We would also like to reintroduce the Barnes Totem as a new Philadelphia icon. I am a native Philadelphian and I know how strongly we feel about our art and architecture as symbols of who we are as a city. We're very connected to our landmarks, and the Barnes Foundation is fortunate enough to have an Ellsworth Kelly beautiful totem in the outside approach that we believe people could use as a touchstone, a place of meeting, and very importantly to a younger generation, a selfie spot. Photography is not allowed in the galleries because of danger to the art and artifacts, and young people and even children need a place to take that picture. Right along those lines, we're looking for an improved social media rollout. Currently, the Barnes does not have a Snapchat presence, and for anyone in our age group, we all know that's an absolute necessity for getting information to us. And you can see in this beautiful puppy picture of Marin that we took that the Philly geotag is the only one available to you when you're at the Barnes. There is no Barnes Foundation geotag, and in addition to creating a Barnes Foundation geotag, we think it would be a good idea to have geotags of various locations within the Barnes. The Barnes is not just a museum, it's gardens, it's classrooms. There are all different settings here that encourage people to explore the grounds. And along those lines, we noticed that Facebook also only has a single check-in point, an official check-in point for the Barnes. But we feel that by putting more check-in points throughout the museum grounds, we would encourage people to experience more of the space and give them more of a reason to return. Finally, we would like to introduce a digital guest book because we want people to see themselves in the collection. As Siobhan and Maria said over and over again, it's very important to people to have their identity represented in something, to find an access point. So upon entering the museum, we would you could have digital photograph taken that would be uploaded to the site, and you could put filters on it that would be cubist or impressionist as the regular collection determines, or if you want a folk art filter or something else that more fully represents you, that would be available as well. And you could go onto our website to find your image, which would be hung in the virtual gallery. And this would also give the Barnes Museum an opportunity to collect data on the people who are coming and seeing these pictures. It would be a great time for us to ask them about their experience and give us a fuller picture of, are we getting to our customer? Is our participant happy? Are they finding themselves in the work? And I think I'm gonna hand you over to Mai.
All right, hi everybody, my name is Mai Nguyen. I am a master's student in design research at Drexel. So going back to our main goal, we as a 2x4 have decided that the barn should be a place of community engagement. It should be a place where people feel welcome and they have a personal attachment. Like Nicole was saying, a lot of people, they feel disconnected. They feel that the museum experience is not for them. And we really seek to change that, especially considering Dr. Barnes's philosophy of education of art for all. So here we have a graph of different neighborhoods in Philadelphia provided to us by Be Heard Philly. Describing breakdowns of people in the neighborhoods that have heard of the Barnes Foundation versus people who have actually gone. And you can see here that there are the majority of in these neighborhoods have heard of the Barnes, there are large discrepancies in certain neighborhoods to actually not turn out, especially in Northeast Philly, West Philly, and South Philadelphia. And according to another set of data, the main considerations for visiting a museum are special events and family time. We believe that these people in these neighborhoods might feel a certain disconnect compared to other neighborhoods. They might not have something to identify with in the Barnes, especially given the stagnant nature of the collection here at the Barnes. So we believe that creating events that speak to you as a diverse member of the Philadelphia community is really important. Excuse me. So one of our ideas was to create to emphasize the family part of the Barnes Foundation. Even though there are educational programs here in existence, we feel that partnering with organizations like the Children's Hospital of Philadelphia or different local schools and showcasing student art would be a great way to get these families out here and to create a more family-friendly environment at the Barnes Foundation. Also, going back to speaking to identities of the Philadelphia community, I think it's really important to cater to a diverse set of interests. People who feel like they need to identify with perhaps a local artist, a black artist, a woman artist. Here is a past exhibition that was done here a few years ago by Nari Ward. He was a Jamaican-born New York-based artist, and this installation was inspired by 19th century flaneurs, a really recurring theme in the Barnes Foundation, as well as African American art. So again, this is a connection to people who normally would not come out here out in Northeast Philadelphia and West Philadelphia that also connects back to what the Barnes is, things that they might not have seen before. Lastly, the main part of our whole 2x4 is to promote this Barnes philosophy of art and education. We believe that by recognizing different organizations and individuals within Philadelphia that embody this modern Barnes philosophy, you will be able to have a wider audience and also spread our values as well. So with that, I give Marin. There you go.
So the second part of building a community hub, we think, could be incorporated through an artist in residency program here at the Barnes. So this is just a geographic representation of the data that you just saw in Mai's part of the presentation. So these are the neighborhoods that we were talking about. We have the percent who have heard of the Barnes Foundation and the percent who have visited the Barnes Foundation. And you can see that the two areas that have the largest discrepancy, people who have heard about the Barnes but have not come down to make a visit, are in Northeast Philadelphia and West and Southwest Philadelphia. So those two neighborhoods, they don't need awareness. They know that we're here, but they need a little bit of an extra push, a tie to them to get them in the doors. And we think that we can do that through partnering with orgs that have those sorts of connections in those communities, like Mural Arts, Philadelphia Open Studio Tours, the Art Church in West Philadelphia, West Philadelphia Local, in order to find artists who could come to the Barnes and do a residence who are from those communities and already have those community connections. So in our talks over the last couple of days, we've heard that there's potential for an e-ticketing system to be put in here at the Barnes, which means that this ticketing kiosk, which you might have seen during our fire drill, you might have huddled in during the fire drill, the ticketing kiosk will be a new opportunity, a new space that can be used, and we think that this would be a really good place to put the artist's studio. It's on that literal and metaphorical boundary between the city and the museum. It's transparent, literally. So it's causing that sort of, that you were talking yesterday about the horizon between the two communities, and this would be at that literal horizon. So people from the community can walk by and become curious about what's going on in this space, and maybe come back when they're done with their residence and see the finished product. And also, the artist in residence, of course, would have access to the Barnes Library, the Barnes Collection, and be able to draw on the Barnes philosophy in making their art. And of course, because this is such a transparent space and it's city-facing, the artists could be, you know, traditional 2D art, sculpture, music, fashion, all sorts of different kinds of art, dependent on the philosophy or the communities that we're pulling from. And then once the artist finishes their residency, they would be able to put on an exhibition here at the Barnes, which would be a special event, like Mai mentioned, in the light court upstairs, maybe here in the auditorium, maybe out on the lawn, depending on where that would be best suited. And that would be an event that would hopefully draw those people from their native community. And after the exhibition, the art can leave the Barnes. It can be reinstalled in the community that the artist came from. It can travel around the city, facilitating, again, that exchange of ideas and of art throughout the city. And then also an added benefit of this is that the artists who have spent so much time at the Barnes and have become so immersed in the Barnes philosophy become ambassadors for the Barnes once they go back to their community, and they can talk about what the Barnes actually is and what their experience was really like, instead of just, you know, the foundation, this big scary words. So.
I'm Kenneth Nimley, PhD student, information studies. I'm gonna speak a bit about the community hub and the outreach education piece of it. So as we mentioned earlier, there's a disconnect, so much of an awareness with the community and what's taking place in the Barnes. And based on the Barnes mission, as you can see, the promotion of the advancement of education and the appreciation of fine art. So what we're looking to do is increase art enthusiasm across the communities. So with the engagement from these communities that have low awareness, we're promoting or positioning an art education outreach program that Barnes pushes out, but digitally. So if you can imagine a platform, a virtual platform, where it's pushed out to the communities digitally, and what it's looking at is promoting something to those communities that are below the digital divide. So for those communities don't have access to technology, they can go to the local library. They could take access to the public computing spaces. So with this technology, we're looking at bringing Barnes art and curriculum to the masses. So with this curriculum, we have, I'll say users, but for this space, I'm gonna say the student. So let's look at it as a student. So we're gonna take a student at a school or in an after-school program. They have the opportunity to visually get curriculum based on the Barnes model to create art from the Barnes philosophy, which they could add their own features in representing of their community themselves. But on top of that, they can create a digital art type pen pal where they can connect with other people, other students, users in their community and across other communities. So I don't need to be in a specific zip code to touch base and create art with someone else. And with this pen pal type of situation, we're creating a social network. So with these social networks, I can reach out to someone, we can create art and hopefully upload it up to the Barnes web cloud space. And if the Barnes has some type of digital display, I could say to my pen pal, hey, let's meet over at the Barnes and view the artwork that we did together. So we have a meetup space at the Barnes, view our digital art, or even grab inspiration during our tours, find a quiet space, and create art together at that time. So what we're looking to consider this as is blending art and technology. So blended learning in a sense. So if we have this blended learning platform, we can reach these lower resource communities and these underrepresented communities. And underrepresented communities, most people think of these poorer communities, African American, Latino, but there's also a community where you have to look at the disabled, which we talked about earlier. So we could use art for autism. We can use art for mental health. So we can promote art from the Barnes in the Barnes mission as a therapeutic type of form or nature. So we can bring these people to the Barnes, increase traffic, access, engagement, and just awareness altogether. So with this impact of reflection, so when we say reflection, we're looking at the reflection of the community that's being brought into the Barnes space, and we're looking to empower our communities to participate in the arts through the Barnes Foundation. So everything is connected with and through Barnes. So Barnes is that outreach, is that helping hand that's being extended not just to one community, but to all communities. So I'm helping this community connect to that community, and it's all based through Barnes. So increasing access into and across the Barnes pipeline. So the pipeline is just the starting point where we're reaching out to these communities to gain access. But what we want to do is once they gain access is keep them in this pipeline and help them throughout the whole pipeline. How can we, so we need to ask questions, how, what do we need from you? How can we keep you coming back to the Barnes? So all this within this digital platform could be implemented. So we can have, as you mentioned earlier, we could have questionnaires, question forms, data gathering that we can use to pretty much promote more of what we're looking to do and spread it across the Philadelphia community.
Part of the pride of the Excite Center at Drexel University. 2 days' work is fantastic. Really impressive. That was great. I'm actually a little weepy. So what we're going to do now is I'm going to turn things over. Shelley and I are going to switch places, and Shelley's going to facilitate a little public conversation. And while she and I are switching places, maybe we get some preliminary responses from our thought leaders here, if you don't mind.
I'm super impressed.
Don't mind.
The marketing piece of it, the community hub piece of it, the digital, of course you've heard me on the digital thing. I just think that's such a giant opportunity. I'm very excited about this. This is, you've really come at it with a fresh set of eyes. The millennials, my millennials, who know what they want and know how they want it, and it's typically not what they find, right?
I agree. I mean, I think one of the things that I really, the words that resonated for me was democratize, because I think there was a lot of discussion with our group yesterday about how, particularly for underrepresented communities, low-income communities, or even immigrant communities, it doesn't say museum, it says foundation. So even that is kind of a little bit of a barrier, and the structure can create a barrier. And everything that this group has come up with is to just make it more appealing, more accessible. And I think that there's the real opportunity. What I really liked about, for example, the digital push out to all different communities was not to give them the entire collection, because I immediately think, I don't want to give them everything for free, right? Digitally, then they'll never come. It's how do I tease them enough to want to come? How do we make the barn so interesting and exciting, and again, draw the connections? Because there are, as we mentioned a little bit earlier, there's a lot of amazing African art here that lots of other communities can connect with, particularly since the growth of biracial and multicultural, multiple different ethnicities is really on the rise, and modern families, merged families, LGBT families, et cetera. So I think that there's a lot of great ideas here where you can roll out and still kind of protect the vision and the integrity and what the barn stands for, because at the end of the day, Mr. Barnes had a vision, but if he was as progressive as he was, and if he was into social justice and inclusion, he would want the Barnes outreach and everything that he dedicated his life to for this collection to be experienced by as many people as possible in Philadelphia and all the visitors that this wonderful community attracts. And I think that, things like the selfie place, and making the barn sculpture part of it.
The reuse of the ticketing center to draw people in. I mean, all of a sudden, because it is kind of a, I don't mean to be mean, but it's kind of a coveted, the way the walls were, this is a very coveted collection, and it's a coveted collection. But all of a sudden you're saying, well, come on in, let's watch and, unearth how this actually all happens, and, the messiness of that, that becomes art later on.
And
I think it's really great.
Yeah, and it goes so well in Philadelphia, because when I moved here, what I loved the most was it doesn't matter what season it is. Everybody's outside, right? Everybody's eating outside, huddled, and there's, but it's just everybody want there's an interactivity. I mean, it's Center City, but it's in all the other communities as well, where you can have that, and the street festivals and the, you know, just having something that's going to draw people in. And then again, to build it around lots of other things and be able to cascade it out, I think that's genius. And I love the transparency. Mm-hmm. And it's, you know, and then you make it competitive, because whoever is in there is going to get a lot of exposure, right? So you're going to want to make sure that they're high caliber.
We had a staff, I didn't tell you this, we had a staff brainstorming session about that ticketing center and what it could become. And the most creative reuse was that we wanted to put Tom in it for his office. But it was interesting for me to sit here as a barn staffer, somebody who, you know, I think when we think about this program, right, and we think about this program as a catalyst, one of the things that was so important is I'm sitting there and I'm thinking, wow, I remember every single suggestion at that brainstorming session. And nobody came up with the artist in residence idea. And on top of that, nobody was thinking about both the sort of inclusion mandate with the idea, right? So I think this is a forum for now internal discussion, and what we're about to start doing was interesting for me as a staffer, and how ingrained you get inside the museum, and how helpful it is to have outside eyes on issues that we face. I wanted to open it up to the audience and see if anybody had questions or thoughts. I know a lot of you are, I saw a lot of cultural domains in your RSVP emails, so I know a lot of you are working on these very issues and may have seen it done incredibly well, or you may be facing some of the very same issues that we're facing today. Certainly, I would imagine a lot of us have the same audiences. So any questions, thoughts? Great, and let's use the mic because we're live streaming.
I guess my question is, I know there's a lot of sensitivities like in the charter of the barns and things like that when it comes to like creating art on site, and I know that's maybe some of the reasons things like an artist in residence hasn't been something you've done in the past. Can you talk about some of those sensitivities internally and like how those rules may have an impact on how we realize some of these ideas?
Yeah, in fact, you know, I think it came up a lot as you all were visiting. You know, I think what I love about it is that we actually have wonderful constraints, right? The collection can't be moved, can't be changed. And I look at that and I think that's a great problem to have, because those constraints make you more creative in how you think about how to approach new ideas. And I wonder if I know you, especially Nicole.
I got up on the couch in the lobby to take pictures through the window because I was told I couldn't take pictures.
Nice.
That was the first thing I wanted
Good
to
job.
Do when I came here. I had my camera out. I asked first. I took my shoes off. But you might have seen that in my slides. I am in such a cell-phoned generation, it never occurred to me there'd be somewhere I could go, because I go to churches in Europe where you can take pictures of everything while Mass is going on. So the idea that you could go into a collection and see this amazing span of artwork but not be able to have a record of it to take with you was just flabbergasting to me. And we talked about kind of some crazy ideas about putting platforms up where people could do what I was doing. But really what it's about is access. It's not really about that rule or that what Mr. Barnes wanted for the collection, because like you said, all of those things are a place for a creative workaround. So if you have to stand on the couch, you're gonna stand on the couch. You're gonna find a way to get in if you're motivated to do so, if you feel like you have a reason and a place there.
Well, and even though you can't take pictures, the collection will always be there. And we talked about issues at other museums. Like, I just went to my favorite museum to go see my favorite exhibit, and for the first time in my life, it was gone. And it just felt like something that was like mine was sort of like ripped away, and it was a really emotional experience. But that won't happen with the barns. You can always come back and see your favorite thing, which is, it has, you know, its upsides and its downsides, but that's definitely one of them. You can't take pictures, but you can always come back.
Do you have similar issues at the library with constraints?
Sure, nobody's allowed to talk.
That makes it tough to be interactive.
We're loosening that one. I would say our rare book collection is you know, between what happens here at our Parkway Central Library right across the street and the Rosenbach Museum and Library, which is we're affiliated. Yeah, you can't, you have to be careful about the temperature and humidity controls and the amount of people that can be in the room at the same time. No flash photography because of the issue around the pages and the deacidification that's occurring, particularly if it's not on a calf skin or sheepskin, that sort of thing. So yeah, there's a lot of limitations when you get into the rare book collections. But in the day-to-day collections, no, the objects are mostly non-archival, highly circulating material, and it's yours to take home and return, we hope. But you know, yeah, those would be. But you know, the shushing thing, you know, it's been serious for years, and breaking that down has been really interesting because we are trying to make it a much more conversational place with our complete redesign. We're literally in the five new libraries that we're redesigning. Literally are putting a living room, what we call the oval, in the middle of our spaces, and inside is banquettes and tables and chairs, and on the outside is the collections. And it is meant for the community to come in, own, and partake. And so that, again, we're looking at a giant paradigm shift on access and inclusion and conversation and civic engagement, more than ever civic engagement. So.
Well, you know, even hotels now. Have completely redone their lobbies and space.
Know.
It's about community. It's about, you know, having fireplaces in different areas, the grab and goes and the leisurely and the ports to charge everything. And it's great because if you want to have conversation, you can. And if you don't, you know, you can go to your room. But I think it's a trend. We have that in our offices as well, a real move, particularly for our innovation centers, to create open workspaces and shared spaces so that people want that camaraderie and that collegiality, and people can still work separately, mm-hmm. but do it together.
Yeah,
but it is a
total
shift.
There's enough space. So if really what you're looking for is quiet, there's always a space you can find to be quiet. But I think it's just not 100% quiet anymore, so, yeah.
Any more questions?
You got one?
Oh, can we get the Stephen?
Okay, I'm going to lob a bomb at you. The real question I'm not hearing about is collegiality, which is to say, you can create portals that reach to, there's a lot of talk about millennials, but what I saw there, and I'm a native Philadelphian, is that there are these working class blocks. We're not talking about class, but that's what we're blocks of people who, for one reason or the other, have not felt a conceptual link with this kind of material. And reaching to them through a digital portal is not going to bridge that link because they're accustomed to those kind of portals. How is it that you get the materiality present to them so that the idea of a complete visit is part of your life? That's the first thing. The second thing is that there is a huge history and presence of people in the city who emerged from those blocks, who are active artists now, who are not represented in this conversation. Okay? They exist in the lobby, in the lobby, in the margins, and they have this history of engagement, both with this material, with the foundation, and that little diorama with the keywords. I noticed the word controversy was the only one that was upside down. And there's this whole history of the way this collection sits within a certain community that's very much a part of the conversation, and it is not addressed.
Yeah.
So the question is the collegiality of people who actually do art, who emerge from those communities, who are not represented by places like Art Church, which is a new presence in West Philadelphia. See what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Those are the
yeah.
real connections that really will connect materially. There's this whole culture that isn't represented in this conversation. And until that is really addressed, you know, you're gonna bounce toward a different audience. But what I call it the old growth Philadelphia is really what you need to be looking at, and none of this addresses that.
I think that something that with the artist in residence, that's something that could totally cater to those artists that you're talking about. And part of the issue is that that was my pet project, and I'm not a native Philadelphian. I'm from Colorado. I moved here 4 years ago for college. So I'm from a long way away. But I think that part of that is reaching out to people who know those communities better, like probably you do, and those artists better. Yeah, and bringing those artists in to be that connection in that space, be in that transparent connection between the two communities would be ideal, to have those artists that you're talking about.
But they're not gonna box themselves.
Well, also I think there's an opportunity here, right? For, let's say we did implement an artist in residence program, what if that artist was not necessarily being chosen by staff at the Barnes? What if those artists were applying and the application process was all public and the artists were chosen by the public? You know, you start to wonder how you can get outside of yourself a little bit in making sure that we're doing the right choices, right? That we're not owning the choice, that we're allowing the community to own the choice. And then in addition, I think you have to look at partners in all areas of Philadelphia and who's doing it well, right? And sort of think about ways to partner with them because we're not gonna do everything well here, right? And just like our community partners are not gonna do every single thing that they do well, they're gonna do some things really well. Those partnerships can strengthen that resolve, right? And I think you might have had something you wanted to say.
No, I was gonna say, I you started touching upon it, which is, I think, you know, implicit, you're absolutely right. There's segregated areas, there's a class, there's a social economic issue here, but that doesn't mean that it can't be solved,
right?
Because that's why I think it was very smart and very wise to think about and have someone in charge of the community outreach, because as, for example, when we were rolling out our Internet Essentials program, which is a low-cost broadband service, it was, some of the communities were very concerned about anything from a large corporation, and we were not getting traction. And we worked through community partners to get into those communities and get past those barriers. So it's there isn't a simple answer to kind of the bigger picture. It's kind of looking at all of the issues that we've kind of outlined here, and I think your input about making sure that we get this entire base of local artists who aren't represented here, who aren't part of the conversation, as part of the next series. I mean, this is like, we talked about that a little bit earlier, and this is, I think, why it's so important to have the public dialogue, because this way we can all be sure, the Barnes team can be sure to recognize some of the things that we didn't talk about in the conversations that we've had. So I think it's great input, but you know, the issues that you hit are head on. I think they've been implicit, but just like everything else, they're not insurmountable. I think it requires the dialogue and bringing another group together, because we all thought this idea of a, you know, an artist in residence out there in the one area would be great, and you mentioned, well, that's not gonna work for some artists. But guess what? There's a lot of open grounds here. So, I mean, there's the opportunity to mix and match, and I think, as I mentioned, a pilot trying lots of different things to see what's successful, because it's not a one-size-fits-all for any of this. It's gonna be a long process.
And that speaks to the data as well. You know, one of the things when we sat down to look at this data is to recognize that even by zip code in this city, when you're looking at a spread of data, there's so much variation in a zip code that you really have to be careful in how you look at that data and think about it's a start for understanding what's happening, but it's only a start, and it requires a certain commitment on the ground to go through and talk to people who live there, talk to people who work there, to understand what those motivations really are beyond a data set. So, you know, that's something we should have said at the beginning. I want to be cautious of time because we're actually at time, but if there are any other questions, we can
sort of
be here.
I was going to say too, the more
contribute to the conversation. And like we were saying, every complaint or everything on that old perception map that we saw, those are our opportunities to change. Yeah. If we don't see that map, and I tried to change that controversy when the word cloud wouldn't do it, but if we don't see that map, then we don't know where to go. So the more feedback we have, the more data we're able to get, the more people are willing to tell us your problems, tell us how you're feeling, tell us how you don't feel represented, and be specific in your complaints, because until people hear that who don't live on that block, who aren't in that zip code, who aren't in the second block of that zip code, we don't know what to do. We need to hear from people. We need people to tell us what do you want? What do you want to see in your Barnes Museum?
Yeah. I could, go ahead.
Yes, that is one piece, but the main idea is, like we mentioned, getting out into the community and finding out what we can do for you. So you telling us what you need, like what you just did, beautiful. But I feel that this needs to happen more often. Too many times we are waiting for the complaint before we start to move, and we need to jump ahead of that and bring that to the communities. That's how I feel. I agree.
So I'm not saying that there isn't an effort. I'm saying you have to be professional about this thing.
Yep.
So you can't sell it by means of a digital platform unless you know that it's not about getting bodies here and doing the normal. What is it about coming to a place that what kind of process are you offering to them? Because really what happens is when people invest in a museum, they understand.
Well, what you're talking about is something that's very Barnesian. I'm looking at Martha right now, and Martha, maybe, you know, Martha's our Deputy Director of Education and Public Programs here. Maybe you want to just say a quick word about Dr. Barnes and him teaching in the factories and taking works outside of the place, right?
As we want to use technology and get the collection out there into the world, it's never going to replace the actual physical experience. And that's what we have. And that's what we want to, that's what's special, like you're saying. I mean, I think that's so true. And, you know, in a world where things are endlessly reproduced, there's the aura of the original. So how do we... how do we get that message out there, I think is what you're asking, to, you know, especially to people who maybe haven't really thought about that before or experienced it before. And what Shelley's referring to is, I don't know how well that fits. I mean, what Shelley's referring to is the fact that Barnes, you know, did really do community outreach. He literally took his paintings to the factory where his workers made the
So what is Barnes 2.0 or 3.0? And that is not to say that the future of the Barnes isn't necessarily to be here, but how does the Barnes reflect the passion and the direction in different places in the city so that there is this absolute contribution from art? Because remember, the collection ends at a certain period of time. And so it doesn't contain anything beyond, what, 1940-something or other? Anyway, so, you know, I'm not an artist, I'll be the first to admit it. But I do think that there is, from that point and forward, from this point on, there, I do think that there's what has been established here is a really good start, but I think that to your point, how do we continue to grow it with the concepts of social progress as a sort of underpinning of it all.
And with that, we are way over time. Thank you for coming back after the fire.